troops on the ground. On paper, the Germans seemed to have everything stacked against them. In fact, their military capability was much greater than this suggested. Many of the German commanders in the field were brilliant operational leaders, able to make the most effective use of their scarce resources. Some of them, like Major General Kurt Mayer, commander of the Hitlerjugend division, led from the front and personally inspired their men by their example. The long-standing German military tradition ensured that they were highly motivated, whatever the odds, and many of the German units comprised elite warriors who did not shrink from sacrificing themselves for Fatherland and Führer. If anything, they embraced it and equated such sacrifice with glory. The Allies considered this attitude fanatical. For the Germans, it was no more than their duty. The German 88mm flak gun, much in evidence in the battles around Caen, was one of the most powerful and most feared guns of the Second World War. The 88 was originally designed for anti-aircraft service. However, when some of them were converted as anti-tank guns and showed their destructive paces in North Africa in 1941, the 88's reputation as a fearsome destroyer was made. Normandy was the perfect setting for the 88. The Normandy Bocage offered maximum chances for a camouflaged 88 to lie in wait for opponents. It was the same at the many fortified villages in Normandy, where some of the 88s were sighted. When mounted on the Tiger tank, the very appearance of the 88 was startling. Allied troops described its 16-foot-long barrel as long as a telegraph pole. This unusual length made the muzzle velocity of the 88 extremely punishing. Firing at 85 degrees elevation, the 88 used armor-piercing fused shells that moved at 886 yards per second. They could hit their targets and create firebursts at distances of up to 2,000 yards. An experienced crew was able to dismount the 88 and be ready for action in no more than 20 seconds, then remount the gun to move elsewhere in less than 60. The Tiger II, or Panzer VI, was the tank equivalent to the 88mm gun which served as its main armament. Like the 88, the Tiger was a superior and much feared weapon. Because of the tank's exploits in Normandy, where 14 of them were used by the Panzer-led division, Allied troops came to believe that three Sherman or four Churchill tanks were needed to challenge one Tiger. Even then, the German tank would dispose of most, if not all of them. Designed as a heavy breakthrough tank to lead assaults by armored divisions, the Tiger II weighed a hefty 75 tons and was powered by a 692-horsepower engine with maximum speed of 24 miles an hour. It was capable of piercing armor 112 millimeters thick at 1,400 yards. The Tiger's own 110mm front armor rendered it impervious to most of the Allied tanks and artillery. The exception was the British 17-pounder anti-tank gun, which appeared on the battlefield in North Africa a month before the Tigers arrived. Even the Russian T-34 had to close to just over 1,600 yards before it had a hope of penetrating the Tiger's armor. Understandably, Allied tank crews generally preferred to outmaneuver the Tiger rather than confront it and approach from its vulnerable rear. Nobelwerfer, meaning smoke thrower, originally applied to the German chemical mortar. Later, the Nobelwerfer became a rocket launcher, specifically the 150mm 41 model, which had six launching tubes. Fired at ranges of up to 7,700 yards, the Nobelwerfer 41 launched its incendiary rockets in sequence to avoid being overturned by the blast. Meanwhile, the Nobelwerfer's crew had to shelter in a trench at least 15 yards away as the rockets were fired electrically using a junction box. A full launch from the Nobelwerfer, including loading, took 90 seconds to complete. The sound was terrifying in itself, a high-pitched screeching. To the Allies, the Nobelwerfer was a truly deadly weapon. It was reckoned to have caused three-quarters of the casualties among the infantry. For the Germans, the Nobelwerfer helped them cope with the serious problem of infantry and artillery shortages in the latter part of the war. The Germans turned instead to massed Nobelwerfers, which were especially effective in putting out defensive fire. task of capturing Caen to the British Second Army under Lieutenant General Sir Miles Dempsey, who had at his disposal three armoured divisions, seven independent armoured and tank brigades, eight infantry divisions, and the Canadian First Corps. The infantry divisions consisted of some 18,400 men, combined from different regiments, together with an artillery brigade. An armoured division possessed around 286 tanks, mostly Sherman M4s and Cromwell tanks, and some 15,000 men. Divisions were apportioned into one infantry brigade, which had three motorised battalions, and an armoured brigade of three battalions. There was also an infantry battalion which used half tracks. Close support for the infantry was provided by Churchill tanks and by special tanks of the 79th Armoured Division. By all sections of the British Second Army, these tanks were officially designated special purpose vehicles, but because of their eccentricity, they acquired the nickname of Falaise. One of them was the flail tank, which was fitted with heavy chains on a revolving drum and proved very effective in clearing the landing beaches from mines. Another of the funniest was the Churchill crocodile, which featured a flame projector in place of the hull machine guns. Did not end with the Normandy landings. They were also used inland, where the Germans had sown a thick carpet of mines and other obstacles. Given the savagery of the German defence, eliminating their strong posts and pillboxes by flame was often the only way. On the 7th of June, the 185th Brigade received a first taste of just how savage this defence was. Attempting to force their way through Libisi, northwest of Caen, they soon found that their powerful supporting batteries were not enough to prevent them from suffering huge casualties. The brigade's assault ground to a halt. The 9th Brigade did somewhat better at Caen, which they captured after the Royal Ulster Rifles caught in death by traversing nearly a mile and a half of ground without cover. The Germans put up such a holocaust of fire that the Ulstermen suffered very heavy casualties, and the advance got no further. The 7th Army of Army Group B, whose task it was to defend Normandy, placed its strongest forces around Caen, leaving the coast to be protected by static divisions, filled in the main with men who were medically unfit, too old to fight, or prisoners from the Eastern Front who'd supposedly volunteered for service with the Wehrmacht. The 21st Panzers, the Panzer Lehr, and the 12th SS Hitlerjugend divisions, which placed an iron ring of defences around Caen, were much more elite forces. They were infused with self-sacrificing loyalty and the resolve and skill to fend off the Allies, no matter what the cost. One of these divisions, the 12th SS Hitlerjugend, the Hitler Youth, belonged to the Waffen SS and comprised the most militarized teenagers in the world. Like the rest of the Waffen SS, they were volunteers. Familiar with weapons since as early as the age of six, the Hitler Youth had been reared for war and reveled in it. Despite, or perhaps because of, their extreme youth, the Hitlerjugend typified fanatical, last-ditch resistance more than any other German division in Normandy. Both the Hitlerjugend and the Panzer Lehr had been thoroughly pounded by Allied air attack as they moved up towards Caen after D-Day. The Panzer Lehr had left behind a trail of burned-out, bullet-ridden wrecks that included 130 trucks, 5 tanks, 84 guns, and a staff car belonging to its commander, Lieutenant General Fritz Beierlein. As an elite, however, the Panzer Lehr had been given the most up-to-date equipment, including the incomparable Tiger II tanks and the Panther or Panzer V, which outclassed but did not replace the German Panzer IV tanks. The Hitlerjugend, whose full battle strength was 21,386 men, had always been treated as special. Later on in the battle for Normandy, in mid-June, Adolf Hitler himself sought to preserve what was left of them by ordering their withdrawal. At that juncture, the parlous state of the Hitler Youth and the two other divisions displayed the grim truth about how they'd fought in the first week after D-Day, and what it had cost them. The fighting at Libisse and Caen, 10th of June, gave notice by special tanks and by special tanks of the 79th Armoured Division. Used by all sections of the British Second Army, these tanks were officially designated special purpose vehicles, but because of their eccentricity, they acquired the nickname of Falaise. One of them was the flail tank, which was fitted with heavy chains on a revolving drum and proved very effective in clearing the landing beaches from mines. Another of the funniest was the Church of Crocodile, which featured a flame projector in place of the hull machine guns. The role of the funnies did not end with the Normandy landings. They were also used inland, where the Germans had sown a thick carpet of mines and other obstacles. Given the savagery of the German defense, eliminating their strong posts and pillboxes by flame was often the only way. On the 7th of June, the 185th Brigade received a first taste of just how savage this defense was. Attempting to force their way through Libisi, northwest of Caen, they soon found that their powerful supporting batteries were not enough to prevent them from suffering huge casualties. The brigade's assault ground to a halt. The 9th Brigade did somewhat better at Caen, which they captured after the Royal Ulster Rifles courted death by traversing nearly a mile and a half of ground without cover. The Germans put up such a holocaust of fire that the Ulstermen suffered very heavy casualties, 5 tons, and was powered by a 692-horsepower engine with maximum speed of 24 miles an hour. It was capable of piercing armor 112 millimeters thick at 1,400 yards. The Tiger's own 110-millimeter front armor rendered it impervious to most of the Allied tanks and artillery. The exception was the British 17-pounder anti-tank gun, which appeared on the battlefield in North Africa a month before the Tigers arrived. Even the Russian T-34 had to close to just over 1,600 yards before it had a hope of penetrating the Tiger's armor. Understandably, Allied tank crews generally preferred to outmaneuver the Tiger rather than confront it and approach its vulnerable rear. Nobelwerfer, meaning smoke thrower, originally applied to the German chemical mortar. Later, the Nobelwerfer became a rocket launcher, specifically the 150mm 41 model, which had 6 launching tubes. Fired at ranges of up to 7,700 yards, the Nobelwerfer 41 launched its incendiary rockets in sequence to avoid being overturned by the blast. Meanwhile, the Nobelwerfer's crew had to shelter in a trench at least 15 yards away as the rockets were fired electrically using a junction box. A full launch from the Nobelwerfer, including loading, took 90 seconds to complete. The sound was terrifying in itself and waiting for opponents. It was the same at the many fortified villages in Normandy, where some of the 88s were sighted. When mounted on the Tiger tank, the very appearance of the 88 was startling. Allied troops described its 16-foot-long barrel as long as a telegraph pole. This unusual length made the muzzle velocity of the 88 extremely punishing. Firing at 85 degrees elevation, the 88 used armor-piercing fused shells that moved at 886 yards per second. They could hit their targets and create firebursts at distances of up to 2,000 yards. An experienced crew was able to dismount the 88 and be ready for action in no more than 20 seconds, then remount the gun to move elsewhere in less than 60. The Tiger II, or Panzer VI, was the tank equivalent to the 88mm gun which served as its main armament. Like the 88, the Tiger was a superior and much feared weapon. Because of the tank's exploits in Normandy, where 14 of them were used by the Panzer-Lehr Division, Allied troops came to believe that 3 Sherman or 4 Churchill tanks were needed to challenge 1 Tiger. Even then, the German tank would dispose of most, if not all of them. Designed as a heavy breakthrough tank to lead assaults by armored divisions, the Tiger II weighed a hefty 70 high-pitched screeching. For the Allies, the Nobelwerfer was a truly deadly weapon. It was reckoned to have caused 3/4 of the casualties among the infantry. For the Germans, the Nobelwerfer helped them cope with the serious problem of infantry and artillery shortages in the latter part of the war. The Germans turned instead to massed Nobelwerfers, which were especially effective in putting out defensive fire. General Montgomery gave the task of capturing Caen British Second Army under Lieutenant General Sir Miles Dempsey, who had at his disposal three armoured divisions, seven independent armoured and tank brigades, eight infantry divisions, and the Canadian First Corps. The infantry divisions consisted of some 18,400 men, combined from different regiments, together with an artillery brigade. An armoured division possessed around 286 tanks, mostly Sherman M4s and Cromwell tanks, and some 15,000 men. Divisions were apportioned into one infantry brigade, which had three motorised battalions, and an armoured brigade of three battalions. There was also an infantry battalion which used half tracks. Close support for the infantry was provided by Churchill, the troops on the ground. On paper, the Germans seemed to have everything stacked against them. In fact, their military capability was much greater than this suggested. Many of the German commanders in the field were brilliant operational leaders, able to make the most effective use of their scarce resources. Some of them, like Major General Kurt Mayer, commander of the Hitlerjugend division, led from the front and personally inspired their men by their example. The long-standing German military tradition ensured that they were highly motivated, whatever the odds, and many of the German units comprised elite warriors who did not shrink from sacrificing themselves for Fatherland and Führer. If anything, they embraced it and equated such sacrifice with glory. The Allies considered this attitude fanatical. To the Germans, it was no more than their duty. The German 88mm flak gun, much in evidence in the battles around Caen, was one of the most powerful and most feared guns of the Second World War. The 88 was originally designed for anti-aircraft service. However, when some of them were converted as anti-tank guns and showed their destructive paces in North Africa in 1941, the 88's reputation as a fearsome destroyer was made. Normandy was the perfect setting for the 88. The Normandy Bocage offered maximum chances for a camouflaged 88 to lie in.